something to start?
I don't know, whatever. I mean,
let's start with something to get you warmed up, all right? Sticks, you can join them.
Sounds good.
It's very subtle when it happens. So.
I've never used these Regal.
Oh, you might like them.
You're a Regal stick guy.
I am, yeah.
I can tell by all the
yellow plastic filler they put in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's because their machine has a little, you know, where it goes on the lathe, is like a little pin or something that goes in to keep the stick on there.
Huh.
And then I guess they just fill it with that plastic afterwards.
I never knew that. That's pretty cool.
Okay. Where did that go? Oh, yeah. Here we go. Let me just rewind a little bit. Okay. You ready?
Sure.
I'll give you a little more volume.
Thank you.
huh?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good though. Gives me a lot to
Great. A lot to
observe.
Observe is a good word for it.
Yeah, no, I mean certainly you've got a nice sensibility about jazz and the vocabulary. Nice touch, nice feel. Couple of things to think about, though. To pick apart, I guess.
Which is good, why I'm here. No, right on me, yeah.
Let's go back to the beginning, though, with the brushes. And let me come over there and swap seats with me. The musical chairs. Brushes were good, except what I missed was a couple of things. You know who Ed Thigpen is, right? Ed Thigpen? He was the drummer for Oscar Peterson for many, many years.
And okay.
The Oscar Peterson Trio. He had a great description of what the brushes generally can do that he called tip, tap, tuck.
Okay.
Tip, obviously, tap, tuck.
All right.
So I didn't really get any tuck sounds out of it. I had a couple of attempts, but they didn't really come through as tuck, you know? So, I mean, that tuck. And I'll sometimes play with snares off. You can hear how the... It's almost like the drum barks a little bit, you know? You can hear the body of the drum. So, tip, tap, tuck. Tip, tap, tuck. So you might want... Is that something you find yourself using, that tuck sound? Or very often? Or have you thought about it?
Jim Petro, Tommy Jim Petro, mm-hmm. We did it for like a day, and he goes, "Oh yeah, let's move on." Oh. So I never.
Yeah, I mean, brushes are, you know, a topic or a subject that, I mean, you could, geez, some of these guys like, what's his name, Clayton Cameron, he's got a great, another one with Steve Smith and Adam Nussbaum that they have.
The Art of Brushes or something like
that. Yeah, that's good. But, mm-hmm. I mean, it's a, you know, a lot of guys will say it's a dying art, but it's pretty alive. But, so those tuck sounds, you know, the common one is like, you know, the aim of the just to kind of play devil's advocate, you know, Alan's description of what he does when he plays the rudimental ritual with the brushes is he talks about there being two sort of requirements, one being playing on the tips of the brushes, right, mm-hmm. as opposed to the side or the fan, and the other requirement being that you have to, because there's no rebound, you have to pick up the stroke, right? So, playing on the tips. When you play that pattern, I was kind of wanting to hear more of that approach, you know, with the right hand to articulate. Right?
Did you show me the two differences, like what I was playing and what you wanted?
Yeah, yours just was maybe a little bit less articulated, I guess.
Okay.
You know? So I'm not really thinking about playing on the tip and picking the strokes up. So here's playing on the tip of the brush. Means that the firmer grip, you know.
Okay.
And here's not so much attention to that.
Alright.
Yeah.
You hear the difference?
I do. Yeah. Now, I mean, there's a sort of opposite school of thought, too. Jeff Hamilton. Ed Stoke to a degree, they don't like that staccato kind of approach with the brushes. You know, Jeff and Ed, they
talk more, especially Jeff Hamilton, they talk more about horizontal kinds of patterns, you know, like edge pattern like this. So both hands are playing on the head horizontally. I don't know if you can see that on your camera, but there's an exercise of heads. See it over there a little better. There's a little more finish on the head, so you might hear it a little bit. I can give you a handout of this, but and this is kind of the opposite of what I was just saying, right?
Yeah.
One hand horizontal, the other hand vertical. This is both hands horizontal. So Ed has a pattern that he does this. One, two, three, four, one. So these are half notes, right? Now I'm just playing with the tip of the brush with no pressure there. But what he does is he actually presses down to outline that half note. One. Or to the accent.
So you press down on one and three?
In this case, yeah. Huh. This is the right hand. But because the left hand is going to go two, three, four, one, two, three, four, and press down on two and four, so you're going to have this. Now, Ed's a little better at this one. I actually ended up going clockwise because it's just a little more natural for me. Ed does it counterclockwise. He does this. One. So both hands are making that little kind of elliptical circle. So one, it's like left, right, left, sticking, right? Without the accent. And then pressing down, you get something like that. And then what Ed would do, cymbal beat. I've actually kind of turned it around. That's a very good. Now, to get back to what I was talking about with that pattern, and I don't remember, were you playing clockwise with the left hand or counterclockwise?
Clockwise,
yeah. So I wanted to hear a little bit more of the cymbal, you know, being articulated. And then you can get more tuck sound. They call it a marcato, where you actually hold the brush down, right? Mm-hmm. It's I'm not allowing it to bounce, and I'm digging in a little, you know. You can even do tap, you know, tap. That was Art Blakey you were actually playing with on there, and he has kind of a variation of that. We call it a conventional pattern. Instead of going in a circle with the left hand, he goes back and forth.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Art Blakey didn't like brushes because he didn't use them very often, and when he did, they sounded great. But you know, he didn't seem to be a big fan of them. So that would be. Couple of suggestions with the brushes, and let me see what else I wrote down here.
Is there any exercises that I could kind of like develop that or know when to play? You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
Musically?
Yeah. I mean, just think of it as an accent, you know, and pretty much anywhere you would accent, you know.
One hand, it's like the right hand plays on the on D, like on the E, and then the accent's on the D. Or no, okay, just whatever.
I would get that video, DVD, with Steve Smith, Adam Nussbaum.
The Art of Brushes.
The Art of Brushes, okay. I think it's called.
Because I have that one, and you just play a lot, but there's not really, when you show a pattern,
when the guys are playing, that you can't see.
Well, yeah, but I'm wondering if it's like the
written out. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. None that I know of.
How would you build in terms of like brushes? Where would you start? Would you go to the ride symbol? Would you go to the...
I noticed you did that a lot, and that's probably something that I don't do as often as I could. You know,
okay. But
certainly, you know, that would be a level in between this. Seamless, you know, because you see the, or hear the guys that do this. Right? What was that? I don't see where the other brush went. So yeah, that was something. Alan, where'd the other brush go? Oh, it's way over there. Yeah. So what you do is you're playing with either sticks or brushes, switch, right? You have those for Alan, you should put this sticks like here. I always see it. So. See those solos with Alan's awesome. He starts off playing with the hand. Then he goes to the brushes, then the mallets, and then the sticks. Yeah. So, you know, here, you put down the right brush. Play a lead in or fill with the left brush while you're picking up the stick with the other hand, right? And the same thing going back the other way. So.
And then where would you put the brushes?
Well, that's a good question, too. I'll keep them both there. If I was going to be putting them away probably for good, I might throw them down in there, you know, but... You said you're playing the ritual with brushes, right? Usually? Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I would say for that, you know, your question about, let's call it really sort of cliche or brush vocabulary of where to put those kind of tuck sounds. Start listening to the great brush players, you know, certainly, Shelly Mann, Philly Joe was really known for his brush stuff, Papa Joe, right? Mm-hmm. And, you know, you'll start to hear kind of similar embellishments, I think. The younger guys with Jeff Hamilton.
Yeah, he's a true boss.
Oh. And just to go back to that concept of Jeff and Ed, you know, where they're playing everything horizontally. I mean, you know, besides that tick, tap, and tuck idea, there's also this tap and slide, you know, that Jeff employs a lot, Ed do. So one of Ed's exercises, I'll pull it out in a minute. So those, let's go over here because you're going to hear this a little better, I think, on this. This head is a little fresher. So let's call those eight note triplets, right? Now I think Ed actually goes the other direction. But I'm more comfortable with that, so.
No, it's actually syncopation.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's that same idea of unaccented notes is just the tip of the brush, right? Mm-hmm. But accented notes. So I'll just do something simple like that. Kind of just general things with the brushes, but like I say, those that DVD, Clayton Cameron had a DVD and a book too. He's got a lot of that, of those tricks like. You know, you can't do with these kind of rims, but so let me see my little notes here. You know, something, again, I was kind of missing was, you got the Riley book, right?
Yeah, the John Riley.
You know, he talks about sort of the two schools of thought, if you will, of ride cymbal playing. One being that, you know, there's an accent on 2 and 4, like if you listen to Art Blakey, who's just playing, you hear his cymbal beat in general being something like this. That's the way he held the stick, and that's kind of, he used that, you know, rebounded stroke. And I do that sometimes. There's times when you hear him, and you don't hear the accent as pronounced. It sounds a little more like the other, you know, school of thought that Riley talks about, where the quarter notes are even. That there is no accent. Mm-hmm. It's whatever the quarter notes are. He says this D, 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 so D. Kenny Clark, you can hear really even chord note ride pads. But what you most guys agree on, though, you never hear this. Yeah. Which is accent on 1 and 3.
Yeah.
You have a slight tendency to do that. It may be something you're doing here that I'd have to watch more. But there's just a little tendency for either that. But so if you went back to John's idea, see if you can hit the play button up in the top left. Hopefully it's still on the same track. Yeah, that's the one. Huh. Oh, did I put the sound down? Yeah, I think I did.
I should.
I'll get it. Yeah.
I don't want to mess it up.
Yeah, and it has to do with the other thing I was going to mention. Feathering? You ever feather?
Feathering.
Yeah. Feathering? Aha! A gap! Feathering refers to playing the bass drum on all four beats.
Oh, the bass drum. Yeah,
that's the bass drum. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I see it. Yeah, it had to burn it. That not only helps you a lot, right?
another point that I wrote down here. I'm not going to do that all the time, right? But especially in the early stages of the development of the tumor or whatever, so that's going to help me really establish the goal.
Like I say, I'm not going to feather all the time because once I start some sort of dialogue between snare drum and bass drum, some comping ideas, I stop that. But
okay.
I think it's a point of departure, so to speak, and it's going to help you to kind of lock with the rhythm section. And it does bring up another point that you kind of alluded to there, is that there are guys that, you know, there's a guy here that teaches here. Ian Froman is his name. He goes, I never feather. He's the same guy that says, I never play rudiments. But he does. But and what it is, I think, is in part evolution of the instrument, in part style that you're playing. So, and Ed Sofigan does a much better job at not only explaining this, but demonstrating this, is that there's basically periods in the development of this instrument where, like with the bebop guys, for the most part, drummers were playing repetitive patterns. The repetitive ride cymbal, mm-hmm. hi-hat on 2 and 4, maybe the quarter notes on the bass drum, but it was more repetitive-based style of playing. And that would certainly include feathering the bass drum, right? But as the instrument developed, you see this maybe in John Riley's book, Beyond Bop Drumming, it moved to more non-repetitive concepts and styles, right? So easiest way to illustrate that would be like what he calls three-voice comping, you know? There, and that's the way you could practice this stuff. Practice the comping. Cymbal, the snare drum, and the hi-hat. Here's another three voice, and it's non-repetitive, right, because I'm not really playing the anything for too long. So three voice, snare drum, bass drum, ride cymbal now. So three voice, so I'm not doing anything with that right now, right? Sometimes like right hand, right foot unison, or left hand, left foot unison. So that's an option, right? And it gets you away from that repetitive hi-hat on 2 and 4, ding, 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 you know,
yeah.
For the most part. It opens things up. But whatever I'm doing here, hopefully the underlying, you know, pulse or subdivision is going to be quarter notes. What else did I do?
things like, not a lot, but a couple of times. But they kind of got lost or something. They're almost, they didn't flow. You know? Okay. So I kept thinking about what the figure is, you know.
But that's like a five stroke.
Like you got, there was a little delay in whatever you did over here and getting back into where the time was, so probably just need to, you know, analyze a couple of those ideas and see how they resolve or whatever. Speaking of resolve, a lot of what you did, you'd usually come out on one. So an example of your ideas weren't that maybe basic, but here's a Bob Moses now technique for getting away from that idea.
Okay.
You've seen Bob's book. It's really kind of obscure now because it's out of print. It was a Modern Drummer publication, but it was called Drum Wisdom. You know Bob Moses is? Mm-hmm. Yeah, Bob was kind of a child prodigy, grew up in New York, went to the high school for performing arts, you know, the school that Fame was based on, the movie Fame.
Okay, yeah.
It was the New York High School of Performing Arts, or Manhattan High School, I forget what. But Bob was a very gifted musician drummer who lived in the same building as Max Roach and Abby Lincoln, and
oh, wow.
I think Elvin lived in his building, and he's a... They have a quality of making music kind of want to stop. They're very grounded, right? Two and four, the backside of one and three, one, two, three, have that sort of back beat or back quality, the backside of one and three, right? It's the beats that the hit people snap their fingers on, right? The people that dance the polka, they say one and three, right? the end of one and the end of three, Bob describes as kind of in your face, and two, three, and four, one, and two. Whereas two and four have that falling away or kind of anticipatory feeling. One, two. They kind of, you know, propel the music forward. All right? So keep that in mind when you do those resolution points. So let's do another resolution point. Let's do. And the other thing, and I hope you got the first part, the timekeeping part, the resolution points. We were doing the end of two in the second bar, right? The mini meditations, 5 to 7 minutes. One, two bar phrase. So that's kind of a comping approach, right? But also, resolution point as a solo thing, right?
Mm-hmm. And of course, I'm picking a 2-bar phrase, but it could be a 4-bar phrase, could be 8-bar phrase too, right? Remember, you're gonna do them both, swung eighth notes, jazz eighth notes. First major resolution point and a one in the second bar. So. Possibilities, and that can kind of help you get away from that tendency to resolve everything on one.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, I probably have my tendency to do it probably more the end of four or something like that. The one, like I say, has that kind of like.
Right, yep.
Makes you want to stop kind of feeling. So. Let me find this brush handout with Ed, and then while I'm looking at it. Well, I'm looking for it. Let me see if there's a... I'm going to give you these 12 triplet stickings. I don't think I gave you that, right?
I don't think so.
Here's Ed's little blurb on the brushes. Do I have triplet stickings here? I actually did want to hear you play that other tempo, too. We have a couple minutes. Maybe I'll give you something with a little more, a little more oomph to it. See? How you manage with that? 12 triplet stickings. 12 triplet stickings. I can write about. What else? What else did I have written down there? I mentioned the repetitive versus the non-repetitive, right? Oh, you know what I'm going to recommend? Have you done that Art of Drumming comp example 4?
Oh, yeah, I've played through that quite a bit, yeah.
Played through it? You should take that same approach with that I was just talking about with the 8 resolution points and make those mini meditations.
How so?
Well, instead of trying to get through the 2 pages, right, take one. Suggesting.
Okay.
And another thing in Bob's book, which is pretty deep when you think about it, he says, you know, a lot of people say, what does groove mean, right? So Bob's definition of groove, he says, inherent in the word groove is the word repetition.
Huh.
Think about it, though, right? Inherent in the word groove is the word repetition.
Hmm.
Right? So I think of those really making them groove. If you're a believer that groove also means
good times,
yeah. Anytime. Not mechanical, but so yeah, I approach those things. I mean, there's times when I'll try to maybe play down the page, maybe 4 times each one or something. That's good too, but I think that sort of meditative approach too is the things will probably stay with you a little better than just kind of, you know,
okay.
Reading through them and yeah, try to really internalize them. Some of them are hard too. I mean, you know, especially on the second page, they bear repeating many times. You know,
What was the other thing I was looking for in here?
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does, actually.
Mini meditations?
Mini meditations.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to have to stop here because I think I'm going to have a visit from my office manager in a minute. But what else? Any other burning questions? Last chance. No, I'm just kidding. You can always email me if something comes up, too, that we didn't address that you would like me to speak to. I don't see those trash triplets cooking. So what I'll do is I'll just write them out real quickly. Let me grab a piece of manuscript paper. These are from social. Get this.
You can throw them on the back of this if you want.
Yeah. You'll never see it again.
So these are just kind of fun,
yet useful triplet stickings that it so gave me once. So the first one is kind of obvious. Second one's even more obvious. Third one is pretty standard. Fourth. This one is. Requires a little longer. And then this one, right, left, left, right, left, left, right, right, left. It's double strokes, right? So two things. Lay as written. Move around. Drums and cymbals. And two, rights equal bass drum, left equal snare drum. How quickly you can fill up a page.
Look at that.
Okay, so, I mean, the first couple on there are fairly obvious, and you're only going to get so much mileage out of them. What does that say?
Oh, it's probably reminded over.
Okay. So number one says, play as written. Should say play as, yeah, play as written, move around. So. Thank you.
jump down to the number 11 and 12 because those are actually double strokes, right? So. Less equal to snare drum.